57 says that the chief priests and the council sought for witness against Jesus to put him to death, and they found none. For many bear false witness, but their witnesses did not agree. The word says that they were looking for people to lie on Jesus. They were fabricating the truth and painting a distorted picture to make Jesus appear to be something that he was not. The text says that their witness could not agree, and they were making up stuff, and it just did not go together. They were liars and trying to pull him down. See, I have a message for any liars that have come to church today. Yes, I have a word for the liars. Listen to this. Mark Twain said, if you tell the truth, you don't have to remember anything. Edgar J. Poe said that a lie has speed, but truth has endurance. You see, 9 times out of 10, when you tell a lie, the only person that you're fooling is yourself. Most people don't believe you. They know you lying. You're the only one that believes your lies. Folks start rolling their eyes. They start looking the other way, and they start thinking about other things, because smiling faces sometimes pretend to be your friend, and smiling faces show no traces of the evil that lurks within. I know I got to use the 2 or 3 heathens up in here today. You see, you don't need to lie. Just always tell the truth. And the second message is for those that are being lied on. You see, you got enemies or haters that will rise up against you whenever you find yourself in a situation. You got haters everywhere, haters in different area codes. You got 972 haters, 214 haters, 469 haters, 1-800-DOLLAR hater all over the place. Because the hater man and the hater woman had hater children, and that's all that they do every day. But do me a favor and stop complaining about your enemies. You see, the only reason you got haters is because you are doing something. Haters only hate people for what they don't see and show them up for what they ain't. You see, if you weren't doing nothing, then they wouldn't say nothing in the first place. But they can't stand to see you happy and moving up, so they're gonna do their best to try to pull you down. So they hate the fact that you are doing fine, and so since they don't have nothing to say about you, they gonna make up stuff about you and create this whole little world inside of their mind. And what they do is they drag you into their drama. But you need to tell them folks to leave me out of your drama. I'm not looking for an Oscar. I don't want a Best Supporting Actor Award. Save the drama for your mama, because I am living in a drama-free zone. All right, let me go hip-hop on you today. There was an old song back in the day, back in 2008, and the song simply said, big ups to all my haters. In other words, what Shorty Low was saying is that I got love for those who don't love me back. Because if you don't hate on me, then probably I would not be elevating right now. And so if it wasn't for your hate, I probably wouldn't be here right now. But I refuse to let you feel how you feel about me to dictate what I'm going to do. And the matter of fact, if you ain't feeling Shorty Low, because that's an old song and I like it, then let me go Bible on your Holy Spirit, Jesus Christ. Because Jesus had the first word for the haters. He said, if the world hates you, know that it hated me first. You see, if folks hate you without a reason, you can't give them a reason to like you. So why do you keep giving major energy to minor people? Why are you giving positive energy to negative people? If they don't like you now, they sure ain't gonna like you later. So let them hate, because the more they hate, the more you elevate. The more they are helping you to get to where you need to be. Because if you didn't start talking bad about certain people, I probably would have never met them right now. And so thank you, because what the devil meant for evil, God used it for my good. Preach, Pastor Jamie, I'm doing the best I can. In this courtroom, and they are lying on him. They are making up things. And then did you notice that in verse 56, it says that the chief priest and all the council, let me read that again, the chief priest and all the council, these are the religious leaders, the religious folk. Have you ever noticed that some of the meanest folk out there are church folk? Have you ever noticed that some of the most two-faced the folk that you will ever meet are inside of the church? They will smile up in your face, and as soon as you walk away, they will talk about you like you are a dirty dog. All of a sudden, you are a topic of discussion at lunch. Some of the worst folk are church folk. They are the most critical and judgmental folk. Church folk are the meanest folk that I have ever met in my life. How dare you look down with your nose of snobbery at some people? All of a sudden, you got baptized, and you the high priest stood up in the midst and asked Jesus, saying, "Answer us nothing, and you don't have nothing to say." Jesus remained quiet. As a matter of fact, Desire of Ages says that Jesus remained calm in spite of that the folk in the courtroom were beginning to wonder and believe that he was truly the Messiah. Why did Jesus remain calm? Because Jesus is not about to let change of circumstances around him cause him to change his attitude. Jesus said, "I'm not about to let you make me come out of character, because I know who I am and I know who I represent." The word says that Jesus held his peace. And that's a hard thing sometimes, because every now and then folk will push your buttons and they will make you lose your religion because you feel like you need to tell them something. But God is saying to you that when you find yourself in a coliseum of criticism, don't change who you are, but remain in character. Just stay who you are. Remember who you serve. And so when you do that, you make people angry, because at the end of the day, when people yell at you and argue with you, they want you to yell back and argue with them. But Jesus says, don't give them that power. You remain how you are. Because when people tell me bad things, they say mean things about me, when they say, "Oh, you know you can't preach," or "You know you can't do this," or "You know you is this and that," I just say, "Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Please, would you continue to pray for me?" Because at the end of the day, they want me to yell back at them. But I ain't gonna yell back at you, because yelling is for fools. And I am not a fool. My mama didn't birth no fool. I am a smart, intelligent man. Folk want you to slap them back. Folk want you to fight them, because they want you to act out of character. Jesus said, "I ain't gonna act out of character, but I'm gonna stay who I am." And so Caiaphas asked again, the high priest asked them again. He said unto him, "Art thou the Christ, the Son of the Blessed?" And so the courtroom is quiet. Everybody breathless, because they want to hear how Jesus would answer the bottom line, no holds barred question, knowing with absolute clarity and his answer would give his accusers the charge that they had been searching for. And so Jesus, who had been silent throughout the whole trial, begins to verbally speak out, and his answer shook the foundation of the world. He said, "Y-E-S, yes, that who's who I am." That is right. I am me. I am the Messiah. I am the Christ, the anointed one from heaven, the God of all gods. I am he to be a ransom for many, to shake the foundation of the devil's kingdom. There is power in my name, and if you say it, I will respond to it. Let me slow that down and bring it back, because you didn't miss your shout cue just now. Let me show you what you just missed as I break it down. Did you get that? The text shows us that if you call on God's name, he will respond. Caiaphas testified and said, "Are you the Christ, the Messiah?" Jesus could not stand there and not respond. He had to say, "Yes, I am." That's why the word tells us, do not take the Lord's name in vain. Because when you walk around the place saying, oh my God, God's aiding and providing capabilities begin to kick in, and he is waiting, ready and waiting to respond. That's why when the word says, those that call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. He hears you when he calls his name, and he will respond. That's why Jesus could not be quiet when Caiaphas asked him the question. As a matter of fact, Jesus said, "Matter of fact, you have testified about me. I didn't even say it. You who hated about me, now you have testified that I am." Okay, only two or three of you got that right now. You're going to get that on Tuesday when you read that. All I'm trying to say is that when you call on God's name, God is ready to jump down from heaven and to aid you whenever you need it. So don't go running around calling God's name out of vain and calling God's name only when you are in trouble. Call him when you are up. Call him when you are down. Call him when nobody is around, because God will respond to what you say. And so here is Jesus as he responds to his name. But wait a minute, the text gets gooder. Jesus says, "And ye shall see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power, coming in the clouds of heaven." I love it, because Jesus just shut down Caiaphas right there. Because when you read the elegant and eloquent writings of Ellen White, Desire of Ages, she confirms that Caiaphas viewed Jesus as his rival. He had imagined that Jesus was coming to take his spot. Poor Caiaphas. Jesus did not want your throne. I got a throne up in heaven. I don't need your corny little chair. I got everything. Everything belongs to me. I know some of y'all are some smart folk in here, so I already did my education and I did some research on Caiaphas. You see, Caiaphas Caiaphas was a Sadducee. And Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection, the judgment, and a future life. And so in one sentence, Jesus denounced and demolished everything that he believed. And so by Jesus saying, you shall see the Son of Man sitting on the right